move on then to how the undernourished and the poor and the illiterate suffer from such reforms. We've had an extremely distinguished panel. We've got Aruna Roy, who's a social activist part of a global, a political movement called MKSS. Welcome to the panel. We've got Surjit Bhalla, who I know and you all probably know because he's often in one of those little boxes on TV debating, as is the guy sitting next to him. I always think of you as a contrarian economist. You're a contrarian on figures. So welcome to the panel as well. You also write about cricket, which is much more understandable than some of the other stuff. We've got Ram Gopal Agarwal here, who is... he started off in Manchester doing a maths PhD and then went to the London Business School and now advises the BJP on some of their policies, having gone to the World Bank and signed off on the 1991 reforms and other things on the way. And we've got Mihir Sharma, who was described on a TV show when he and Surjit appeared discussing this very subject. He was described as the preeminent economics and political columnist of his generation. On TV,
he's a youngster.
On TV, he did
Nobody
not make
else
that,
writes.
On TV, he did not make that face. He was just absolutely straight and didn't show any signs of anything at all. We've all written books, or the four of us have written books, on India and its problems. I'm a journalist, as you've just heard. And we've all written books and thought about how do you make change in India? And what do you actually need in order to get the place moving and look after the poor? I want to start off with the thought that economic reforms really began very quickly in the year 1980s, and then we had the Big Bang reform in 1991, and that was forced by an external financial crisis, which Ram, I've discovered, actually signed off on some of it at the World Bank, as I just said. And then for the next 25 years after 1991, the reforms carried on. There were all sorts of changes, but people kept on saying, look, the country still isn't really moving. Does there have to be another crisis, internal or external, in order for India to get moving? And hey presto, on November the 8th, a prime minister who'd been in power for 2.5 years and needed to begin to show that he was actually achieving something, created his own crisis. At 8 o'clock that evening, he went on television and said in 4 hours' time, 86% of the banknotes that you're holding in your pockets will no longer have any value unless you go and change them in the bank, you can't use them. That created a countrywide crisis. And we're now going to debate whether one should see it in that sort of context and what change it might generate. But let's think of it as the Prime Minister's creating the crisis, whether he meant to create a crisis, how broad his aims were, very few people know. But I'm going to start off with you, Surjit. Do you think I'm right in rating the Modi November the 8th, 8 p.m.'s, or roughly, speech alongside what happened in 1991? Without going into the 91 reforms themselves too much.
No, I think we were rolling along, the economy was rolling along nicely. But what we need to remember is that India has consistently performed below potential. And it's the performance below potential that has been a continuing crisis in India. Why that has been the case, perhaps we can discuss later. But I do think, so therefore, we didn't need the crisis because we've already had a crisis, but we need a Big Bang crisis, if you will, to get everybody's attention together on this issue. So I think I have a mixed answer that yes, part of the reason of demonetization was that you needed to create a crisis to get everybody on board. And you know, one other thing that I want to emphasize, particularly with demonetization, and I might as well do it at the beginning, is that in India, India is one of the worst countries in the world in terms of tax compliance, stated differently, black economy. So therefore, what Modi did, if it helps out in substantially reducing our venality, our lack of tax payment, it would be a major success. So we had a crisis, continuing crisis. We needed this shock. And now we'll wait to see whether the shock is delivering.
Yeah, Mihir, in your book, Restart, the Last Chance for the Indian Economy, I'm sure there'll be another last chance if you want to write another book in 10 years' time, but the last chance for the Indian economy. You said that India had been held together in the 2000s by rubber bands and hope. And I thought they'd get a laugh. And then you said that change would have to come, change would come, because 1.2 billion people needed it. I think that's a bit optimistic, but do you think that change has come with demonetization? Is this what you were waiting for?
Well, I think that perhaps on reflection, I should have clarified that I didn't exactly mean anyone to drive the Indian economy off a cliff. I assumed that most people would you know, recognize that I was hoping for positive change. I think one of the things that I've learned over the past few months about Indians and all of us is that we don't much care what somebody is doing as long as they're doing it. And so therefore, it appears to be that the number one criticism that you get if you question demonetization is, what's your problem? At least he's doing something. And it's like, I'm not quite certain how doing something has become a criterion for doing the right thing. All right, these two things do not naturally follow. So, you know, these endless WhatsApp forwards that everyone receives saying, you know, stand with the Prime Minister, he has the right intention, nobody else has done anything. It's like, I don't care about intentions. I don't care about the fact that that he's done something. Just because something needed to be done and this is something doesn't not mean that you do that thing. All right, so, you know, frankly, yes, we need. Sometimes we only progress through crises. We shouldn't go out and seek crises, and we should not definitely try and assume that just because something has had a massive, chaotic, and disruptive impact, we will wind up the better for it.
Aruna, you've got strong views on the on how it was implemented and how people weren't consulted. Would you like to follow on? So far, we've got Surjit, who's being tactfully non-committal, and we...
No, I will be quite committal after. Now that he's started.
Surjit never starts the combativeness, all right? Surjit, so he likes to lie back and wait for somebody to make a point, and then he jumps on them with, you know, close out.
I mean, it's coming.
We're going to finish up, if I can just interrupt you for a moment. We're going to finish up with two pro and two anti. Well, let's just let that evolve. Aruna, will you tell us what your views are?
Well, I'm an unlisted number. I'm not in the list of speakers, and I almost didn't come. So anyway, so I'm here by default.
No, you were on the list of 2 weeks ago, and we thought you weren't coming.
I'm very happy to be here, because I really represent the people who are unlisted, except on Aadhaar cards. So anyway, so here I am, and I really do think, if I follow you up with a beautiful Rajasthani folk story, told us by Vijay Dandeta, Biji for short, since I am in a literary festival, and which folk story we hear that there was once a big change in the jungle, and they decided that they had enough of the lion and they wanted another ruler who would be far more democratic. So the king, which was the lion, stepped aside and he said, all right, you elect your own leader, and they elected the monkey. So the monkey became the king, and the lion was told that you can only eat dead animals and you can't kill for your food. But one day, tempted by a rabbit, the lion killed. The entire animal kingdom ran to the monkey, and the monkey was up on the trees. So they said to him, we've been betrayed, please come down. So the monkey leapt from one bough to the next, second to the third to the fourth to the fifth to the sixth. And they said, what are you doing? You're jumping from one bough to the next while the rabbit's being eaten. He said, can't you see? I'm doing so much for you. I'm jumping from bough to bough. I think India needs its government mostly for the poor. We are still a country. We have improved. Things have changed. It's not as if things have been the same, and it's not because of 2 years or 3 years of this rule. Systematically, every government that's come has improved us, whichever government it might have been. In Rajasthan, we change governments every time. So whichever government it's changed, something has been done for us. But I think, for the first time, I think poor people feel that they are no longer part of the vision of any kind of development, that we are really on the margins to suffer whims and fancies, because this demonetization has impacted us extremely badly. Many of us have died because we've not been able to access food, because crises of all sorts, silicosis patients, sick anemic women, we've died. We still today stand in huge queues in banks and we can't access money. So for us, it has been a crisis which is unexplained. Three words are thrown at us so that we become quiet. Many friends of mine have asked, why is there no mobilization? Because we've been told three things. One is that if you speak against it, you're corrupt. It silences us. The second thing is that it helps terrorism. So we keep quiet. And the third thing that is done to us is that we are told that you'll get 15,000 rupees in the bank because money has come in to so many lakh crores have come in, so you'll all get 15,000 rupees in the bank. But what has not been done, that nobody has explained to us what this demonetization process is. Nobody has answered our questions as to why in a democracy we need a prime minister not to consult anybody, including his own cabinet, not to consult parliament, not to consult the Reserve Bank of India. And are we really progressing towards, at best, an oligarchy? Are we leaving democracy behind? And whatever it is, such a huge impact on the whole country, on every single citizen, something must be explained to us before things are done. And the right to information law, which we fought for and got, gave us the right to at least know what was going on in government. Governance has now become everybody's business up to a point. We all understand that it's not the business of an elected in small number. So there are huge questions hanging, which I don't think have been answered. And every time, give me a month, give me so many months, give me so many days, give me 50 days. So we're giving time, but what's going to happen, nobody knows.
Ram, you're in the seat.
Yeah.
Respond.
Well, contrary to what John said, I have no advisory role for BJP. And I have no knowledge of what's behind the Prime Minister's mind or BJP's mind in introducing the demonetization. What I would like to do is to suggest that this has happened and it has a lot of adverse effects, but our aim should be to see where do we go from here. How to...
No, could we come on to that later?
Yeah,
could we
no, but I'm just framing
what's
the
happened
issue.
And discuss...
You know, I'm not going into the details of it, but I think it is important to realize that not too much gain would come from post-mortems, just analyzing whatever's behind it and so on. So perhaps we should be thinking ahead. And this point about crisis is an important one from what little I have observed with the Indian policy making. It is true that we move mostly when we are in crisis. We are an argumentative society and it is not easy for us to move in any big way unless there is a crisis. So perhaps a crisis has been created and this may prepare the ground for making many important issues that we have been struggling with. And of course, we do need a vision of where we want to go and how we can utilize this crisis to make a progress towards that. So something has happened and now our theme should be how to make the best of it and go forward to realize our goal. Thank you.
Surjit, how would you deal with some of the criticisms you've heard? I mean, this is prime ministerial disruption. I mean, disruptors and disruption are very fashionable these days, but they're supposed to come out of Bangalore, not out of the prime minister's office.
Yeah, okay, we've discussed this for the last 10 minutes as to whether a crisis was created. And Mihir, of course, had his nice punchline about the economy has been driven off a cliff, if I quote you right. Let me take the first part about the crisis. And I want to ask the audience, just think about the following economy, which is, we in India, Aruna says that the economy should serve the poor. I don't think there's any disagreement, not only in the panel, or in the audience, or in the world. I think around the world, every government thinks that it is there to take care of the bottom half of the population, whether it is democracy or dictatorship or whatever. So I don't think we should push forward this notion of India is somehow unique, that Indian governments have to respond to the poor. No, all governments have to respond to the poor. And I will take the poor as the bottom half of the population. Let's make it bottom half. So therefore, even as living standards rise, you should take care of the bottom half. Well, how has India done? Well, how many of you know that the public distribution system of food grains, which has been in operation for the last 35, 40 years, and which was enshrined as a law in the previous UPA government, that, and they spend about 1% of GDP, that 50% of the food, that the Food Corporation of India says that it is redistributing in the name of the poor, does not accrue to the poor, does not accrue to anybody at the table over here, and does not accrue to Mukesh Ambani. Where does it go? It goes into thin air, which is another word for saying it goes into corruption. It doesn't accrue to anybody, okay? It goes now, you hear about food grains being, if you will, destroyed or because of rain or whatever, and where it is going is to liquor shops or liquor companies, or it is being channeled into mills who get it at a low price. The point I want to make with that, number one, let us get away from in the name of the poor policies. Bismil Muflis. Let us try, what we have to do is try and deliver to the bottom half of the population, which no government in India has been able to do, and they've been pumping more and more and more money into this. So that's a crisis. One other thing. That's a crisis. Second, how many of you know in the US, the Internal Revenue Service does a cataloging of how much income tax evasion there is in the US? And they find out that of every $100 of taxes they do collect, personal income tax, 20 is not collected. In India, the number is, out of every $100 of taxes, or rupees if you will, that we do collect, 200 is missed out. You know, we know, everybody. Is that a crisis? Why don't we complain about that? That listen, this is venality at its extreme. What demonetization was attempting to do, and that was one of the three targets that Modi had mentioned, which you elucidated, is attack on black money. Black money is, another word for black money is tax evasion. How many of you think that the government should not attack tax evasion on such a mammoth scale?
But how does wiping out 86% of the currency overnight deal with tax evasion?
Yes, it does.
How does wiping out 86% of the taxation overnight?
That brings up
you've gone on to quoting some of the substance from your article in the Indian Express on tax reform, which I understand as tax reform, and I was going to come on to later.
Yeah.
But how do you link what you've just
because
said?
Because you know what, you have been writing about it. He's been writing about it. He's been written a book on it. I've been writing about it. These are the policies that should be done. Has it happened?
But none of us said you should take 86%.
And that's why I'm linking. And we are sitting in judgment of a mega big bang policy 2 months after it's happened. 2 months. It hasn't even happened 2 months.
I don't think Mihir and I mean, if I can call you in on this one, know what the policy is. What's the policy?
So therefore, if you'll allow me, the policy is to attack black money. What the consequence
of
tax evasion?
That's a hope. One second.
In the amount of cash that has been collected, there is, unless you believe that all the cash collected, 15.4 trillion rupees is all pristine white, if you believe it's not all pristine white, a lot of that money is black, which has been submitted by people, and they will be caught.
But 97% has gone back
and
into the banks
have been
without
able to
being
do
caught.
It.
97% of those notes have gone back into the banks without being caught.
That's why I'm saying, just wait for, as I have written, wait for the policies to come out. If they do not come out, and a year from now, it is business as usual in India, I will be the first one, and I would have said it long before that, that this is a massive failure. But let's not judge it today.
But it was announced as an anti-black money thing on November the 8th. And a little bit later, it was, hey presto, it's all about a cashless society. Mihir, take over.
Yeah.
Well, okay, I mean, I think that, I think we all agree, as Surjit has said, that you need to reduce the amount of black money in the economy. I, in fact, John, wrote an article about 8 months ago saying that we need to move towards less cash in the economy in order to reduce the salience of black money.
So but not you overnight.
You caused the crisis.
Right? But not
absolutely. I mean, clearly the Prime Minister is reading me in detail. But no, at no point would anyone genuinely suggest, even then, that you take away all the money in one go. And at no point did anyone make the claim that just by taking away the money and not changing anything else, would you be able to crack down on tax evasion? Would you be able to fix black money? What in fact is happening here is that the money has been taken away, the cash has been taken away, a large number of people may or may not, we don't even know, have laundered large piles of cash, all right? Once they've laundered those large piles of cash, the pressure will be on the government to demonstrate that, as Surjit says, no, we will go after the people who've managed to launder this cash. So you, me and Surjit, not Surjit, you and me will be have our taxes audited, all right? no, but you know, everyone can find themselves at the receiving end of a completely arbitrary decision by the taxman. In end November, the rules were changed that govern tax officers to allow the last guy, the tax officer, the assessing officer, to go after anyone, to examine the assets of anyone that he chooses. Earlier, that had to be done at a much higher level, right? So now the tax guys, who, as you all know, are the most honest people in India, all right, are the ones who are going to determine whether or not the other 99.9% of Indians are honest. And the Prime Minister will say, look, I am releasing these my honest officials, and I've told them to be honest, so now they will be honest, unlike the previous 60-something years. All right, so I am releasing my honest taxmen on you. Whoever they pick is, you know, a corrupt fan of terrorism and needs to go to Pakistan.
Wrong. Factually wrong.
Okay,
listen,
not factually, it hasn't happened yet. 6 months from now it's going to happen.
No,
you just told me to wait, and this is the only thing that's going to happen.
You should have read in the papers, I know you don't read anything beyond Business Standard, is that what has happened is the government has brought in the leading accounting firms to consult with them as to identify how to identify. Has that ever been done in India before?
But
they've called in the leading accounting firms to help them identify so that there isn't a misallocation of priorities.
I completely trust the private sector on this one, yes.
But people are...
No, you would want the PDS system, the guys running the PDS to run this, because those are the guys you trust, and which are siphoned off...
I don't want anyone to be going to be given carte blanche by a powerful prime minister to say, for the sake of black money and terrorism, investigate the entire country. Everyone's put money into the banks.
Nobody's.
Seriously, people normally call consultants in when they know what they want to do and want the consultants to endorse it. So, do they know what they want to do, or do they want consultants to tell them?
You know, I don't. I'll tell you this story is worth telling. Is that about a month ago or so? Somebody who was sympathetic, like me, to demonetization, was arguing exactly like Mihir, you know, how can we, there are millions of people, how can we identify them? And, you know, and I wrote a column on this, which says, we now live in the computer age. You get the computer to identify, not a tax official. And the computer can identify very fast. Then the question is, Do they have the will to go after that? But that's not what you're addressing. You're saying it's going to be impossible, it's going to be arbitrary, etc. No, the computer is going to do it, and I trust the computer more than the government or the private
sector. If they come out with transparent rules as to how this happens, I will take it back.
Yeah.
Okay. I feel like Arnab Goswami on trying to separate the boxes on TV. What I didn't explain was that Mihir used to write a column on the Business Standard, which he still does, but he also is now a leading columnist for Bloomberg. Do you think that your call for less cash was read by the Prime Minister on Bloomberg or on the Business Standard?
I think that I'll take that question completely seriously. I think that, in fact, the Prime Minister is probably reading none of these things, right? And this has emerged from, the truth is, if you really want to understand the thought proceedings that gave rise to demonetization, you're in the wrong panel. You need to be over at the RSS panel. All right? And there you will understand where the deep, you know, economic thinking is coming from that actually gives us ideas like this. And that we then, who are supposed to be thinking about the economy, will have to sit back and analyze or praise or criticize or whatever.
I was going to bring you in on the fact that there's been very little public protest on that, on this whole exercise in the last two months or so. If I was a political leader in UP or Punjab with elections coming up, I'd want to have people on the streets. I'd be wanting to close towns down with bans, with strikes that close down the shops. None of it's happened. How do you explain, given the fact that you disapprove because of the impact on the poor, and I don't think anybody would disagree with that, how do you explain the fact that there's been so little protest? Is it fatalism? Is it what people have said to me? But we're used to shortages. We're used to shortages. There's just shortage of money. Or is it because they think that the rich are being got at, which they're not, because 97% of the money's gone back to the bank and the corruption will continue as it has done? What is it that stopped any serious political protest apart from Mamata Banerjee in West Bengal?
Well, I'm going to say a couple of things before I get on to that question. Black money is not stashed in notes anymore. If anyone thinks that, it's a fallacy. Because black money is invested in the restaurants you see on National Highway number 8 as you go to Delhi. Black money is invested in land, in bullion, in investment abroad, in shares. So money is not the way in which you track black money. Evasion of taxes, you just have to read P-Sinaps to find out how evasion of taxes is colossal in India. There is no attention to the evasion of taxes. There are some dramatic exposés. That's it. We had a systematic way of looking at evasion of taxes. Perhaps India would have done a bigger job to get the economy in order than to have black money tracked. Because black money, like corruption, or like many of the other catchwords, is something which completely reduces you to a defendant. If you say anything, 10 goons come and say, how dare you talk against corruption? So you say, okay, yes, you must sacrifice for the nation. So when these goons come, and there's a lot of the social pressure now, many people have been beaten up, even in the middle class, for saying frankly on television, that it's something that shouldn't be done. So there is a certain degree of physical fear. The second thing is, when you're standing in front of that bank, morning, noon, and night, to make sure that your children get food, make sure that your ill people, many have died, by the way, get to hospital and get that care taken. You are there to see for the small social necessities of a marriage or a birth or whatever. Where is the time to mobilize? So you've really hurt them at a point where you really can't get them even to sit and think properly in a group. So people are sleeping, even today, in the bank in Bhim, which is on the way to Udaipur. People stand, and you can see the miles and miles of queues of people wanting to get money. So that's one reason. The second reason is that people have been told that if you keep quiet and don't protest, you'll get that 15,000 rupees we promised in your bank account. So they all say, like this woman in Telangana, when she was asked, why are you not protesting? She said, no, I don't mind suffering now because I'll get 15,000 rupees in the bank. When you talk about mobilizing, you need money to mobilize. Even if you have to buy a ticket to go from Bhim to Jaipur or from Bhim to Delhi, it's impossible. So when there's no liquid cash for a community of beings who have nothing, how are you going to mobilize? So the problem with mobilizing is that they do mobilize in small groups where they can walk and access a point. But it's these large mobilizations are not possible.
But is there resentment, because of this?
There's great resentment.
And will
there's
that
anger.
Play out in politics? How will this
no,
come out in
there's anger,
voting?
But there's tremendous anger because they're facing, not merely, just now, a few days ago, a woman I knew who was undernourished, malnourished, died because she had to be brought in 108, the ambulance. Every time she had excess money in the bank, she couldn't walk. She died of malnutrition and hunger. She's one case. But there are many people whose hunger has prevented them from actually coming to the bank. So I think we'll have to take a point of view in which we see not only black money. See, we are mesmerized. We had a corruption campaign, we got mesmerized by corruption. Did we ask the details? Did we ask for how are you going to stop corruption? Even the Lokpal bill, how is it going to stop corruption? We have to ask questions about details. So also with black money, I want to know, what is this black money? Where is it? Is it just in the cash notes? Or is it stashed away in Switzerland? And if it is stashed away in Switzerland, why aren't we doing anything about getting that money back? Or who has this black money? See, black money is one of those phrases. And I know that as a social activist, if I am told that you are seditious, then you just gag me. If you say to me, you are supporting terrorists, you gag me. If you say you are anti-corruption, you are really working for the corrupt, you gag me. And people have been gagged to some degree because of these fears and basically because of lack of money. There's no liquid cash. And I know tomato sellers who are selling their tomatoes, throwing them on the streets and selling them for 5 rupees. People who have never eaten peas are eating peas now because it's 10 rupees a kilo. We've never heard of peas selling for 10 rupees a kilo. If you look at the losses to the farmers, to the vegetable growers, to the markets, and I know that business has come down even for the sugarcane industry. Because you need liquid cash. And I heard a person who is actually sympathetic to the ruling party telling us that, you know, I need 90 lakhs a day to keep my chain going. Am I using black money? Am I illegal? But I need that liquid cash. And if you don't have cash, then industry and business goes down. We all know that business has actually gone down. If you walk into any market, you find much less people buying or selling.
Ram, would you like to come in?
Yeah. From my own personal experience, and I come from a business community, I would say black money was and is a very important part of corruption. Of course, black money moves very fast, you know, in land and other things. But the fountainhead of corruption was with the black money in the informal sector and formal sector also. So the black money is a very important part of creation of corruption and so on.
What about political parties?
Political parties also. So to me, the issue of black money has to be seen as a component of the fight against corruption. And of course, we have to try to see what are the other measures needed to stop corruption. But it's a good starting point. And the very fact that it has created so much commotion is exactly as John said, has created a crisis atmosphere where government can take tougher action. For example, political parties, I think an atmosphere has been created where people can point out that political parties are taking an active part in money laundering. And an atmosphere has been created where some action can be taken on reform of electoral funding. So this move has in a way succeeded in throwing open the problem of corruption, and perhaps more measures can be taken. But it has a very important role. The black money should not be underestimated in its role in promoting corruption. As I said, I can say it from my own personal experience of last 75 years.
Just one thing I want to say. When we wanted information from political parties as to funding under the RTI, all of them got together to deny us. So we need to know where the party funds come from, That's where corruption actually.
Well, the Prime Minister's now saying the BJP should
do it.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly.
Poor Prime, I feel bad for him.
No, wait.
He can't even tell his own party to open their accounts. Poor chap.
Just wait. It's
worse than Manmohan Singh. I really feel bad for Narendra Modi.
Are you going to accept Mihir's thing as the answer to me, or do you want to answer as well? The Prime Minister said he wants the BJP to do.
Actually,
do you believe it? Do you think it'll happen?
I do not believe it, because if you're not pro-transparency in every way, how are you going to make your party transparent? The websites are all gone. Websites are being whittled down. There is no consultative process except through social media. I feel that transparency, if it has to be promoted, there is a law in this country. There is a law for suo motu disclosure. Why doesn't the Prime Minister insist that every ministry and every department must put all its information out on the website? If he does, then we'll believe him if he says his party is going to be transparent and it's going to declare its
Surge
assets.
Surjit, they're dying to come in on this, but I'm not going to let you, because I'm going to bring you in on something else. We need to move on, and we need to move on to the impact on the economy. On one hand, we had Arun Jaitley saying on November the 19th that there was some little initial inconvenience without any significant economic disruption. The Prime Minister has talked about any suggestion of an economic slowdown being anecdotal. I suppose anecdotal is personal experience, and we've all got anecdotal personal experience. And then you've got Manmohan Singh, poor old guy, why is he put up to do these things? saying it's the beginning of the end of the Indian economy, which is the biggest load of whatever that's been said in the whole for the 2 months. Tell us where the economy is going.
Look.
And the World Bank is now saying, IMF, saying 6.5%.
6.5.
Down 1.5% or something.
Let's just be somewhat objective about this. I think it's a very important question.
But you always are.
Yeah. That's what I'm going to try. The numbers are as follows. That prior to demonetization, which is India's growth rate between April and October, was somewhere around 7.2, 7.3% growth rate. That we know. Now, all of these guys I have, including some Andy Warhol types who are saying want their 15 minutes in the sun and the economy is collapsing to 3.5%, I don't know. I agree with you. I don't know why Manmohan Singh is joining the Andy Warhol
camp. I was about to say, did you mean that?
It is a good question. But maybe UP elections are coming and he's been compelled to say so. Be that as it may, let's just look at the facts. The tax collection post-demonetization, because we have data for official government tax collection between November and December, is actually higher by about 10 percentage points than what it was last year, April to October. In other words, government revenues have gone up by 10%. Second, there is absolutely no doubt that demonetization will and has affected the economy for the last 2 months, November and December, and I would say it will peter out in January. It has affected.
You think it'll carry on, or you think it'll pick
up again? No, so that's what I'm coming to. So it has affected it, and let us say it has affected it by 100 basis points in 3 months, which is 4% of GDP annualized. It turns out that agriculture, everybody was saying, you know, all the leading newspapers, including mine, Indian Express, etc., were saying that agriculture was going to fall over the cliff. Maybe they got that from him. And that really,
everyone gets everything.
The rubby crop is finished, etc. What do we know about the poor? What do we know about the rural sector? What do we know about agriculture? Agriculture output is expected to be up at least 4.5% according to CSO, very likely 7 or 8% according to the fact that acreage, which should have been affected by demonetization in the rural areas, cash-trapped, completely cash-dependent economy, acreage in the rubby output went up 7% over last year. So I am saying, and we can check this out in May or so, that when the final number comes out by GDP growth last April to this March, it will be somewhere very close to 7.1, 7.2%, which means in net terms, demonetization would not have had an effect. In gross terms, it did, but it will be more than compensated by the growth of the poor, by the growth of the farmer, by the growth of agricultural output.
Mihir, you're an economist. Do you want to comment on that briefly?
Well, I think the first thing is it's entirely possible that there will be that Surjit is correct. I have two things that I think to say that are sort of valid here. The first is GDP growth in India is, and the numbers that determine GDP growth are not quite as, they tend to, the informal economy tends to be practically guessed at in our GDP numbers. Normally, this is not a problem. All right. If there are methods that you use to try and estimate what the informal economy is.
Always. CSO, not me.
I'm not saying I'm saying people in general. And those methods are not for the informal economy are not quite as accurate as the methods that are used to estimate GDP for the formal economy. All right. And the informal economy, as we know, is the one that's dependent on cash. That's the one that may be more affected. Now, the question really that a lot of people will be asking themselves when the numbers come out is that even if GDP growth looks decent, is it the case that this is because the numbers are over-reflecting strength in the formal economy vis-a-vis weakness in the informal economy? And that's a perfectly reasonable question to be asking. The second problem that is going to emerge is that already people do not believe, for good or bad reasons, I'm not talking about that here, but already that many people do not necessarily believe the Indian growth numbers. Okay?
But
Surjit and indeed myself disagree with this. I think the numbers have by and large been fairly accurate. All right? However, there is across the world a sense that Indian growth numbers are increasingly cooked up and that they look like the Chinese. All right? This is feedback I get all the time. People ask me, are your numbers real? I never used to get that earlier. I think it's a mistake, but it happens. If the GDP numbers don't show the impact for demonetization, I fear we will have to spend a lot of time in this country actually defending our numbers in the first place. And the third thing I have to say, John, is that who cares about GDP? This is not about GDP. This is about nationalism. This is about the soul of India.
No,
all right. If you're by asking that question, you are asking an anti-national question.
That's why I snuck in taxes. Taxes is a formal economy, and that is showing robust growth. Is formal economy.
I'm moving on from the nationalism point. At another Economic Times conference, the quote I gave was Aaron Jetley speaking there. At another Economic Times conference in Delhi, in the Taj Man Singh Hotel, on about January the 3rd or 4th, the whole audience was encouraged at an economic conference to stand up and recite, which they did, led by Mr. Bhargava, who's head of Maruti, and Rajiv Kumar, who's a leading economist and has run various things, and the Paytm guy, the pledge, which the Economic Times has been running as an advertisement in their newspaper ever since. And the pledge ran like this: remonetize India's campaign manifesto. We pledge to rise and protest, and protect, they might protest. We pledge to rise and protect the world's fastest growing economy, to stop doubting and start acting. We pledge to spend more now, to revive demand in India's markets, to help workers keep their jobs, farmers sell their produce. We pledge to teach and bring those around us into digitization, to help fellow citizens participate in our new economy. We pledge to issue less cash. These were these businessmen leading it, and everybody by this point was reciting it. We pledge to use less cash, to make it available for those more needy in the villages, to bring more activities into the formal economy. We pledge to remonetize India. And then, I have tried this on the platform already, ask anybody in the audience to stand up and tell me what you think happened next. They sang the national anthem at the end of an economic seminar. Now, the Supreme Court said a few weeks ago that it should be played in the cinema, like it used to be in my youth in Britain, that it should be played in cinemas. But the end of an economics conference run by the Economic Times, they stood up and they sang, somewhat sheepishly, the national anthem. And then we see the BJP with a resolution at a recent thing that they had talking about remonetization being a sacred movement. that would lead to a clean economy. So is this nationalism?
I want to say a couple of things. I don't know how many of you in this audience think that economics is a science. Do you think so? It is not. You cannot predict. If you want, you can add 2 + 2 and make 4. I can produce 2 sets of economists fighting each other in 10 minutes. So economics is a perception of money from a point of view of ideology. You'll accept that. So whether you see money doing this or that, it's not absolute. We have been conned to think that because you and I are not economists, I was a student of English literature, that therefore, and if you work with poor, of course you're totally damned because you know nothing. Therefore, when economists speak, we must hold our breath and listen to them. But I read 2 or 3 books when I was very young. One was called How to Lie with Statistics. That book was an eye-opener. It was written by a British statistician. And he said to me in that book, you can choose your figures. And you can choose whatever you want to project, whatever you want to prove. So I think I would like not to recite this chant. I would like to doubt. I would like to question. No matter whether anyone calls me seditious or anti-national or foolish, I would like to know what goes into a decision. I would like to know what mathematics goes into that decision, what ideological position goes into that decision, because economics is not mathematics, nor is it for Indians who believe in astrology, even astrology. So it is actually a play on ideas, on investment, on concepts, and I would like to know. The second thing I'd like to ask is, what is this GDP? I don't know how many of you, read The Guardian. There is a person called, I don't know how to pronounce his name, M-O-N-B-I-O-T.
Monbiot.
You should read George Monbiot, and you should read Sainath, and you should read people who are well-versed with figures. They come up with a totally different analysis. Piketty comes up with a third analysis, and he's an economist. So I feel that one must have the option to look at economics from diverse points of view, and one must ask the basic question with GDP of distributive justice. The country may grow very rich. We might have 13, 15 most wealthy people in the world in India, and now the figures that Oxfam has brought out just a few days ago says that the difference between the richest and the poorest is enormous, and 50% or 60% of India's wealth is owned by 15% or 2% of India's population. So when these
58% by the top 1%.
58% by the top 1%, thank you. So in that situation, when we are dealing with a nation with 1.2 billion people living with $2 a day, questions are very different. So the health of the country, I know Mahatma Gandhi is not popular because we have the Prime Minister on the KVIC calendar in the place of Mahatma Gandhi today. But nevertheless, I would like to quote the man I saw actually as a very, very young child in Birla House. I would like to ask a question, what goes with Gandhi's statement that the health of a nation is decided by the condition of the last person?
We're going to open it up for the moment of questions. Surjit, you just want to say something quickly.
You know, this thing about 58% own 2% of the wealth or vice versa or whatever. This was Oxfam's Andy Warhol moment. And let me explain. All of us here, 99.9% of Indians and 99.9% of the people in the world, their major asset, their major wealth comes from education. It doesn't come from anywhere else. If you now look how much of the education is now owned by the poor, by the bottom 50%, 70%, 80%, etc., it's more so than at any time in world history. So we can go on and on as to who has what, but the real wealth of individuals, yours, mine, Mihir's, is education. And that has improved radically and will improve further. So I, like you, if you will, the only difference between the statistics, you know, all those fancy words about lies, and statistics on what have you. Look for a key over here, but the light is there. We've heard them all before, quite honestly. But you know what? An economist at the end of the day has to answer whether his assessment or her assessment was right or wrong. Political scientist never has to answer that. A social scientist never has to answer that. And a social activist never has to answer that.
That's not true. We are indicted. We are told we are anti-national. There are cases against us. We are called seven-star activists. We have
Let's
to answer.
Talk.
No, but I want one question answered. I agree that literacy levels have gone up. Many people have got degrees. But look at your unemployment figures. If you want to look at rural India, come to my village. There were 2 postgraduates, now there are 200 postgraduates, all unemployed. You look at what happens in the wage market in Kishangarh, where after demonetizing, 90% of the labor has been laid off. For me, these are the figures that matter, not what the GDP says.
Okay, questions. Yeah. One there.
Hello. Namaskar, ma'am. Aruna, ma'am, mera sawal aap se, kyunki Adam Gondvi saab ki ek line hai. कि तुम्हारी फाइलों में गांव का मौसम गुलाबी है मगर ये आंकड़ा झूठा और ये दावा फरेबी है सवाल आपसे है क्योंकि आप ग्राउंड पे काफी काम करती है कि जो वो लोग जिनकी रोज की तनख्वाह 80 रुपए 90 रुपए जो नरेगा में काम कर रहे हैं उनकी जिंदगी पर डीमोनेटाइजेशन का क्या असर पड़े थैंक यू
टेक अ फ्यू
टेक
अ फ्यू मोर एंड
टेक अ फ्यू
ऑलराइट टेक अ फ्यू वन देयर इन द मिडिल बिहाइंड यू स्ट्रेट बिहाइंड यू Yeah, it's standing right beside you.
Okay, I think we are confusing two things. Corruption.
Hello.
Corruption versus tax compliance. I agree that tax compliance would have improved because of demonetization. But has corruption come down? You have to come down to ask people who are working on the street, who work businesses. Nothing has happened. Only the new notes have converted from the old notes. And they say,
and the question,
and I close
please.
With the question, how has it improved our situation? Gandhi ka note ab bhi sab jagah chalta hai. Wahi Gandhi hai, jo purane note pe tha, aur naye note pe bhi hai.
And then about 4 rows back on the right, somebody with their hand up.
I'm just wondering.
All right, okay.
Hello.
Whichever. Okay, that one.
Just wanted to ask, after 60 days or maybe more than 60 days of demonetization, will the food from Food Corporation of India 100% reach population now? Thank you.
And one more, and then
this
we'll take answers.
This is regarding demonetization. There is some content on the internet that there was a Parliamentary Affairs Committee meeting in 2012-10, which came to know that 1 lakh crore worth currency was outsourced to print out in US, in Europe, UK or German or some 3 companies, and because of that reason, later on it was found out that there is some duplicate notes coming, or there is to take care of that currency, it was primarily done. How true it is.
Right, we're taking some answers now. Could you bring the microphone into the front row, please, because we've got some people here. Who wants to go first?
Surjit.
Sorry.
Has demonetization stopped theft of food?
Oh,
and tax
no,
compliance?
Look, it's a very... After you finish applauding, it's a very good question, which I have tried to attempt to answer and several other people. I said before that at the end of 2 months, to think that demonetization would have ended corruption or would even have begun to end corruption is, I think, completely inappropriate question, meant to get a few laughs, but really is not a serious question. Nobody ever said corruption will be ended with demonetization. The crisis...
He said it. Prime Minister said it.
You had the stage, sir. I'm having the stage now. You had the demonetization. It was a shock to the system. Let us wait and see. Their policies have to follow in order to stop the creation or decline. Nobody's saying, before you guys quote me, nobody's saying that ever black money creation will be stopped. It hasn't stopped anywhere in the world. It won't happen here. What you want to do is to significantly reduce it. Yeah, for that, you have to create incentives for tax payment, and you have to create incentives for not having in real estate and other areas and election funding a sink for black money, a sink for corruption. Just wait, and then we can assess. You can tell me I was wrong. You can tell the government they were wrong. You can tell Mihir he was wrong. Never, or you can even tell Aruna she was wrong. We do not know who will be right, who will be wrong. Let us just wait. But I think I am committing myself to the view that this will substantially increase tax compliance. The policies that will follow will substantially increase tax compliance. And a year from now, black money in India would have substantially reduced.
And 10 seconds on your tax thing that you think will change. But no, just 10
look,
seconds.
We await taxes. I mean, it is really venal, right? I mean, I think I'll take more, just 20 seconds on this. I was surprised as to how I could not foresee, because I think I'm a social scientist just like Mihir Sharma does, that people will be so venal that they will hire these unemployed or not so employed or whatever people to go stand in line to convert money over and over and over again, such that they then had to bring
in the
election
tax. Thing. Come on to the proposal.
Okay. Now, with the proposal that I have submitted to the Indian Express, not to the government, is that we institute, we lower taxes drastically, and we increase the payments to individuals who do not have enough income. A negative income tax, if you will. We do away with PDS, we do away with NREGA. This will not cost the economy anything more, but it will improve efficiency in tax payment, it will decrease tax evasion, and most importantly, it will deliver more to the bottom 50% of the population.
Okay, we're going to throw two more questions into the pot, then we're going to go for more answers. Two questions in the front, I think, two people.
Everybody believes that the most of the black money is in the property. So why, if the government had the intention to do away with the black money, why didn't they demat all the property like the shares, and the trading can be done only through the browser of the, especially in the urban
And the
properties.
Question, please.
Yeah. And I think more than 100 lakhs.
And the question.
Mamata Banerjee has the answer, because it's a state subject, and property taxes as well as stamp duties is a state
sir,
subject.
Okay, I've been told we've got to
Ask
finish.
Mamata Banerjee why she's opposed to demonetization.
Sir, my question is very simple. Okay. Do you think any other government, if had brought this move, would they have been criticized so much? A very simple question. If what? Any other leader other than Modi would have brought this, would there have been as much criticism of the move? That's my simple question.
Aruna, you mean as much praise of the move?
No, criticism.
You mean would there have been as much praise of the move?
Fine.
I just want to answer that question in Hindi because it's an important thing. There have been language debates about what the Lit Fest is about. भाई ऐसा है कि नरेगा के काम करने वाले से ना तो किसी ने पूछा कि तुम्हारा हाल क्या है पहले भी नहीं पूछते थे अभी भी नहीं पूछ रहे हैं उसका हाल डीमोनेटाइजेशन से ये हुआ है कि वो अपने दिन के जो दो छोटे छोटे चीजें वो खरीद नहीं पा रहा है उसकी पेमेंट नहीं ले पा रहा है वो क्योंकि वो पेमेंट बैंक में डालते हैं और वो जाके खड़ा रहता है उसके लिए वो वहां खड़ा रहे या काम करे बहुत मुसीबत है क्योंकि उसी के नाम से पैसा है वो वहां अंगूठा लगाएगा दस्तखत नहीं करेगा तो नहीं इट्स स्टिल द
वी आर क्लोजिंग डाउन थैंक यू वेरी मच एवरीबॉडी
और मैंने 10 साल से लिख रहा हूं कि नरेगा इज वन ऑफ द मोस्ट करप्ट प्रोग्राम्स इन द वर्ल्ड
नरेगा नो नरेगा नरेगा
थैंक यू एवरीबॉडी थैंक यू पैनल गुड नाइट
नरेगा इज बीन डिक्लेयर्ड द बेस्ट प्रोग्राम To struggle against poverty by Stiglitz. And Stiglitz is an economist of international repute. So I contest that. Surjit.
Thank you to our panel for that incredibly spirited and thought-provoking discussion. And thank you. Thank you to the audience. What a great discussion to end the day with. Look forward to seeing you tomorrow for some more, hopefully, just as spirited discussions. Thank you.